Let us pray. Father, thank you for your word. I pray that you teach us, that you change us, you heal us, you remove whatever has come into our hearts and lives that distract us from you, that we would bow before you and say, Lord, we want to know you and love you, that we would serve you faithfully. Forgive us of our sins, Lord. Forgive us for lack of worship to you, and may we worship you with all that we have. In Jesus' name, amen. Author Henry Nouwen tells a story of a family he knew in Paraguay. The father of a doctor spoke out against the military regime and the human rights abuses. Well, local police took their revenge on him for having spoken out against them. They arrested him, or they actually arrested his teenage son. They tortured his son and killed his son. Well, enraged, the town folks wanted to turn the boy's funeral into a huge protest march, but the doctor chose another means of protest. At the funeral, the father displayed his son's body as he had found it in jail. He put his son's body the way that he found it in jail, naked, scarred from electric shocks and cigarette burns and beatings. And all the villagers filed past the corpse, which lay not in a coffin, but on a blood-soaked mattress from the prison. It was the strongest protest imaginable, for it put injustice on grotesque display. Let me ask you, is that not what God did at Calvary? The cross that held Jesus' body naked and marked with scars exposed the violence and the injustice of the world. At once, the cross revealed what kind of world we have and what kind of God we have. A world of gross unfairness, a God of sacrificial love. In his novel, Ah, But Your Land is Beautiful, Alan Paton tells the story of a man named Robert Mansfield, the headmaster of a school in South Africa during the days of apartheid. And apartheid was a cruel system of racial segregation. It was a horrible time. Well, when Mansfield's school was barred from competing against a black school, he finally took a stand against apartheid and resigned his post. A friend said to him, "You know you will be wounded for doing that. Do you know that?" And Mansfield replied, pointing to heaven, "When I go up there, the big judge will say to me, 'Where are your wounds?' If I say, 'I haven't any,' he will say, 'Was there nothing to fight for? Was there nothing to fight for?'" What an interesting question, right? What an interesting question. Was there nothing to fight for? Because in the church today, we fight over many things. Typically, we fight over our rights, how we have been offended. But do we fight for unity, compassion, forgiveness, the gospel of Jesus, the lost and dying? Sometimes we fight each other. Paul wrote in Philippians 2, "Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and one in mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but rather in humility value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others." It is a time we change our battle plans, that we change how we fight and who we fight, and we remember who the enemy is. The enemy's the enemy. We remember what it cost God to set us free. We see the seriousness of our sin, and we examine the cross, and we realize how much it cost to set us free. That we serve as Christ served, and love as Christ loved, and heal as Christ healed. That we listen to his calling and say, as Isaiah did centuries ago, "Here am I, Lord, send me." As the Lord Jesus in chapter 10, as we're there looking at the chapter 10, as Jesus is looking at his disciples, he's looking into their hearts, he's examining their minds. He understands their fears, their hurts, and their shame. And he gives them a calling. He gives them he gives them authority. And he gives them identity. He wants them to see what he sees. He wants them to do what he's been doing. So he calls them and he gives them a mission here in chapter 10. Now, I imagine the Lord is sitting with his disciples near the Sea of Galilee, preparing them for this mission. They're eating fish, tossing the bones into the fire. The sea is reflecting the early morning sun, and there's a slight breeze, and the smell of the fire is constant. Well, Jesus gets up, and the disciples get up with him, and he walks toward a village. It's west, and the disciples are straining to listen as he's walking. And he stops, and then he turns to them, and he says, "I'm sending you out like sheep among wolves." They're startled and confused when they hear him say this. "Aren't we the ones that you're giving authority and power to? Aren't we the ones casting out demons and healing the sick? How are we sheep and the wolves are the world? How is Christ giving authority to the disciples, the work of sheep? Are we not the ones who are taking the initiative and attacking aggressively? How is this possible?" Yet Jesus needed them to know something very important about what it means to have the authority of Christ. It means that we have the authority to be crucified, to die, to give up, to serve, and most importantly, to love. Christ was calling them to go out into the villages, into the cities, and eventually into the world to lay their lives down so they could give Christ away. They could heal people. They could speak the truth. And they could give freedom to the lost. They would love. And they would keep on loving. They were not to attack, but to love because of what Jesus, because that's who Jesus is. Jesus, as he stood with his disciples, looking them in the eyes, into their souls, he was warning them what it meant to follow him. He was preparing them. He was showing them the cost, and he was showing them the challenge. He was telling them that the message that they were to preach, but the people did not necessarily want to hear it. Many will fight you. Many will come against you. And the authority Christ was giving them was not to attack back, but to love all those who attack them and to keep on loving them. The authority was to love. He was preparing them because these men were being asked to give up their very lives to speak the message. So I challenge you today, be prepared. Be prepared. Are you ready for the calling of Christ? Because that calling is love, and loving those who want your head at times. Be prepared. Be ready for the call. Be ready and prepared for the challenges. Let us be like what we read in Revelation chapter 12. Let us be prepared. In Revelation 12, it says, "They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. They did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death." These followers, these disciples were ready and they were prepared. Are you ready? In Matthew 10, the Lord Jesus gathered his disciples and gave them authority. He then prepared them for the mission that they were to embark. Now, during this sermon in Matthew 10 that Jesus is giving, he's very specific to the 12 and what they will encounter, especially verses 5 through 16 as he's sending them out on this specific mission. And he's telling them what most likely they will encounter, what they're to bring and not bring, and what they're to do when they go on this mission. Then as we get to verse 17, we see that Jesus is now looking toward the Great Commission, the time when he is ascended to heaven, and the disciples are to spread the gospel not just to the Jews, but to everyone. He's looking beyond the disciples to all disciples, to everyone who will follow him. And as he's standing with these 12, he sees thousands upon thousands, 10,000 upon 10,000, standing behind his 12. And he sees them all in a unified whole, a magnificent community, a loving brotherhood. And his words are echoing through the centuries. When following Christ, you need to be prepared, and you better be completely devoted to Christ. Because if you're not devoted to Christ, you will give up. You will throw it all away. So are you ready? Number one, wait on God. Let's look at verse 17. "Be on your guard against men. They will hand you over to the local councils, and flog you in their synagogues. On my account, you will be brought before governors and kings as witnesses to them and to the Gentiles. But when they arrest you, do not worry about what to say or how to say it. At that time, you'll be given what to say. For it will not be your speaking, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. What a beautiful promise. The first thing that Jesus said in this passage is, be on guard against men. So Christ is sending his disciples to men, to the world, to the people in the villages. Yet be on your guard against men. This is being shrewd as a snake and innocent as doves. Go to the men of the world, but be on your guard at the same time. Love them, but be on your guard against them. This calls for wisdom. This calls for wisdom. This calls for clinging to the shepherd. This calls for us to rely completely on Christ. As the disciples were to travel throughout the villages and towns of Galilee, they were to speak the message, they were to heal the sick, they were to cast out demons. Well, as Jesus stood with his disciples, they had traveled probably to a small village. And everyone could see the people in the village. They could see the men, the leaders. They could see the children and the women walking to and fro. They could see merchants, carpenters, beggars. What Jesus saw, and what he saw so clearly, is what we don't always see, though. He saw a people where there was no generosity, no compassion, no concern. He saw the townsfolk. He saw their faces. He heard their cries. He saw their souls. But he knew something else. We're all sinners. And as sinners, we can be comfortable in our sin. We can be comfortable with, well, that's my sin. That's who I am. You know, just live in it. That's where the problem is. And so this is why we should be on our guard. Number one, people do not know God. People do not know God. The key reason Christ said to be on your guard against men is that men don't know God. They just don't know him. People do not know God. People will think they know God. People will try to think and study and say, well, I know God. This is who God is. That's why he's sending them out there in the first place. He's sending them out into these villages so they can be shown who God is. When men don't know God and they don't know what is right and good, they will say, well, this is right based on my own thinking. Right and good becomes a matter of opinion, desire, and human thought when we don't know God. So Christ said, be on your guard, because these men whom you go to will hand you over, will try to get rid of you, and they'll try to get rid of you through legal channels and shut you up. They will kick you out. They will punish you. And then they will send you to the courts. They will try to ruin you because the message of Jesus offends. We're all sinners and we're comfortable in our sin. And Jesus confronts sin. They will ruin you because of the message of Jesus, because of Christ himself. In John 16... the Lord Jesus warned his disciples in John 16. It says, they will put you out of the synagogue. In fact, a time is coming when anyone who kills you will think he's offering a service to God. Because they think, well, we're doing this for God. You see, men don't know God because they are killing those God sends. But this has always been the case, right? As you read through the Old Testament, the prophets of the Old Testament were constantly going to God's people, which is interesting. And as they're going to God's people, God's people are the ones hurting the prophets, shutting them up, rejecting God's word. You know, what's interesting is you read Jonah, the anti-prophet, if you will, who does not want to be a prophet. When Jonah finally goes to Nineveh to preach to those heathen people, and he didn't want to preach to those heathen people because they're bad people and God shouldn't be kind to those people. God, you shouldn't be kind to those people. You should just be kind to me. He goes and he preaches in Nineveh and they repent. Now, Israel wasn't repenting, but Nineveh repented. They confessed their sins. Well, many times you don't see that. When prophets preach, most of the time it was rejected. Because men don't know God, they don't want to know his word or even abide by his word. They will reject his word. And so when you go and you speak the message of Jesus, you will have a confrontation. Because it exposes our sin, and we like our sin sometimes, a lot of times. And when we go to the world and we tell people about Jesus Christ, he's offensive. But he's also grace. He's also forgiving. He also heals us. And as we preach the message, it's uncomfortable. As we preach Christ, it's going to become increasingly uncomfortable. We may become increasingly marginalized. Are you ready for that? Are you ready to be prepared for the battle and the spiritual warfare and to remember who the true enemy is? So let us be prepared. Be on guard against people because they don't know God. They don't know what is right and good. And if people don't know God, then they won't recognize his word. And they won't recognize his compassion. They won't recognize his love or even his message. That is why it was important for Jesus to pick these 12, to spend time with them, to love them, to reveal himself to them. He wanted them to know him so intimately that they would tell the world who he is. And we together are to know God so intimately, to know Christ so deeply, that we can tell the world who he is. So I challenge you, be prepared. Number two, people will fight you. As he talks about this. People don't know God will end up fighting you. What a joyful message today. They will do what they can to marginalize the message, isolate the preacher, and ridicule the mission. There will be this conflict. You will be denied your rights. You'll be kicked out and flogged. That's a very painful experience. And let me tell you, you're going to want to fight back. God, kill this person. And here is God saying, I want to love that person through you. I mean, I can understand why Jonah felt the way he felt. That's a very human way to react. You will not be popular. You will not be well-liked because the message is not liked. And sometimes we just want to be liked. You know, when Jesus warned his disciples that they were to be handed over to the local councils and flogged in the synagogue, it was something where people knew you and they knew you as well. You knew them and they knew you. It was something where these were relationships they had built probably over the years. He's talking about people who should know God. Some of the most difficult places to serve can be the church. Betrayal by a stranger is one thing, but betrayal by a friend, oh, that deeply hurts, right? Jesus knew this all too well. Jesus knew betrayal. In fact, as he's eating with his disciples the Last Supper before he goes off to be crucified, in John 13, he says, as he's speaking about Judas, I know those I have chosen, but this is to fulfill the scripture. He who shares my bread has lifted up his heel against me. And in Psalms, the psalmist wrote, if an enemy were insulting me, I could endure it. If a foe were raising himself against me, I could hide from him. But it's you, a man like myself, my companion, my close friend, with whom I once enjoyed sweet fellowship as we walked with the throng at the house of God. That's painful, isn't it? And God knows that pain. He's endured that every day. Jesus knew this kind of betrayal and this hurt. He knew what it was like for those who were to love him and denied him. In John, in chapter 1, we read, he came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Could you imagine having been gone maybe a week from your family, and you go to your house, and the door's locked, and you forgot your key, and your family's in the house, and you knock on the door, and you could see them opening the window, and then they shut it, and they don't open the door for you. That's what John 1:11 is like. He came to that which was his own, and his own did not receive him. They didn't open the door. Are you ready? Are you prepared? Number three, God is sovereign. You know, it's interesting that Christ sent his disciples as sheep among wolves, but he told them to go to the man, to the people, but the people will stand against you because of the gospel and fight you. So you will go and you will preach, you will heal, you will be challenged, you may be sued, you'll be harassed, you'll be kicked out. But in the midst of all these trials, God wants you to use the platform from whatever you're put in to preach the gospel. And so if you're persecuted or you're sued or you're harassed, wherever situation you're in, I will preach the gospel wherever I am. I will speak of Christ no matter what. Whatever platform I have, I will preach Christ. He wants you to stand ready to preach wherever you are placed. Jesus said they will arrest you, and in the place that you are arrested, speak. If you're in the courtroom, speak. If you're in jail, speak. If you're in the torture chamber, speak. If you're in isolation, speak. Preach to the walls. Don't let the place you are kept keep you silent. And the beautiful truth here is that God will give you the words. Isn't that what we read here? Christ will, the Spirit of God will fill you and you will know what to say. He will fill your mind and you will know what to speak. You will declare the message. You will hold on to the truth. You will wait on God because he's sovereign in the midst of your struggle. People are not sovereign. People and governments are not invincible. God is getting his way. Are you ready to follow Christ? Are you prepared to preach his message? Let us not waver. Let us not fear, for God is with us, and his Spirit will empower us. His love will compel us, and his holiness will overwhelm us. So let us be prepared. Number two, perseverance is faith. Perseverance is faith. Verse 21, brother will betray brother to death and a father his child. Children will rebel against their parents and have them put to death. All men will hate you because of me, but he who stands firm to the end will be saved. When you are persecuted in one place, flee to another. I tell you the truth, you will not finish going through the cities of Israel before the Son of Man comes. Asian Access, or A2, a Christian missions agency in South Asia, listed a series of questions that some church planters, did I say point two? Perseverance is faith? Okay, couldn't remember. Perseverance is faith. Yeah. So A2, when they're in these countries that are closed off to the gospel, very dangerous places at times, and they have safety concerns for the people that have come to Christ, that want to be baptized even. And so they asked these, now Christianity in this country has grown somewhat popular among the poor and the tribal peoples, but the following seven questions serve as a reality check for what the new followers might experience. And here are the seven questions. Are you willing to leave home and lose the blessing of your father? Are you willing to lose your job? Are you willing to go to the village and those who persecute you, forgive them and share the love of Christ with them? Are you willing to give an offering to the Lord? Are you willing to be beaten rather than deny your faith? Are you willing to go to prison? Are you willing to go to die for Jesus? Those are tough questions. Now, somewhat, I don't fear for my life in terms of preaching the message here in America, preaching Christ. There are no armed guards now waiting to take me away or take us away. Thank God. I hope I could answer yes to that question. I know that I'm not going to lose my job. You sort of expect me to preach Christ. A lot of these are tough as you look at that and you face the reality that some people face each day. How would you answer these questions? Are we ready? Are we prepared? Number one, and this is intensely personal. In verse 21, you see how intensely personal this is. Brother will betray brother. I mean, this is intensely personal. This is about family. The gospel can tear families apart. The gospel can bring division because of what we see in verse 17. Guard against man. People love their sin. But we see, though, it's transformative and effective, but it's also difficult to hear. People don't want to hear the gospel, so they will fight it. And when they fight it, they will fight you. And the biggest challenge and spiritual warfare you will ever face, the most difficult heartbreak you will encounter, will be those closest to you. Satan, the enemy, will use everyone and anyone he can to undermine you and shut you up. That's a spiritual warfare. If you become an evangelical Christian in Laos, the communist neighbor of Vietnam and Cambodia, you will likely to be asked to sign a fill-in-the-blank form. And it's not a membership card. The form reads in part, should be on the screen there, I, and then you put your name in, who live in whatever city or village, believe in a foreign religion which the imperialists have used for their own benefit to divide the United Front and to build power for themselves against the local authorities. Now, I and my family clearly see the intentions of the enemy and regret the deeds which we have committed. We clearly see the goodness of the party and the government. Therefore, I and my family voluntarily and unequivocally resign from believing in this foreign religion. If you sign, you promise not to participate in this foreign religion, Christianity, in every reported case under punishment law. If you don't sign, you can expect humiliation, harassment, persecution, including probable imprisonment and torture. Now, this document has been verified and authenticated by the World Evangelical Fellowship's Religious Liberty Commission and other sources. This is really happening. And hundreds of rural Christians reportedly have been forced to sign the form in public, then compelled to form or practice animistic rituals. If you don't sign it, what happens? You know, in Laos, there will be people who may not, they may not know you, but turn you in. And then there'll be people who do know you and you know them, and they'll turn you in. It's intensely personal. This does not mean that you turn your back on them, though, as they may have on you, because that is what our human nature wants. He doesn't want you to build a wall around your heart and say, never hurt me again. Instead, he says, I will keep loving as Christ keeps loving me. And the supernatural work that God is calling us to live is in the spirit-filled life when we love and give, even those who are out to destroy us. That's the supernatural love of Christ. That's the beauty of who he is. That's the cause of Christ, the way we are willing to go and lose our lives, because the gospel is so powerful, so real, and so transformative. Then we say, I would rather die than give this up. Number two, stand firm. The Lord Jesus gave his disciples a challenge. Stand firm to the end. The end means the end of your life, the end of this age. Never give in. Don't let the world sway you. Don't let the world transform you or conform you into its image. But be transformed by Christ and the power of the Spirit. It means you stay vulnerable when your whole mind and body and spirit is screaming at you to stop doing that, to stop loving and to stop serving. Jesus warned his disciples that men will hate them, and through that hate, they will try to stop you, because sometimes we just want to be liked. And sometimes we just want to be left alone. And sometimes we just want to live below the radar and say, just leave me alone, don't talk to me. And God's gospel is so powerful and in our lives that we say, I just have to speak and tell others. We have to be like Jeremiah in Jeremiah 20 when he tries to hand in his resignation to God and says, God, I'm done being a prophet. I'm tired of it. And then he says, I'm not going to speak your word anymore. And he says, the word of God is like fire in my bones and I can't help but speak it. Let us be like that. There's fire in our bones. Where the gospel's on ourselves and in our minds and in our bodies and everything we do, we just can't help but say it. Now, the Lord Jesus knows that this is going to not necessarily going to happen every second of the day, that you're not going to face this all the time, but as a community where we are to love each other, where we are to be connected to each other and unified, the world will fight against us. That is why the world is going to hate us. So let's make sure, if the world is going to hate us for the message, that we love each other. Let's make sure that this is a safe place, a sanctuary where we love each other. where we can demonstrate compassion, love, and mercy. Let us draw strength from each other. Spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but instead let us encourage one another. Let us stand firm together. Let us stay vulnerable together. Let us pray together. Let us speak the message of Jesus together. Let us not do this as individuals that Christ is speaking, but let us do this as a community. You know, Christ, as he was speaking this, as he was looking at the 12, I imagine he could see all of the disciples through the centuries. And he was saying, don't be individuals in this effort, but be a community. Build a community where you can come together. You can enjoy each other's fellowship. You can endure the persecutions together. You can pray for each other. You can love each other. And through that, tell the world who Jesus is. So let us be prepared together. And finally, never stop. As Jesus concludes this section, as the morning is slipping into noon, he walks over to the well and draws some water. His disciples drink and they soberly contemplate the words of Christ. Following Christ is not, following Christ from a human nature point of view doesn't sound very exciting, right? As you read this, you say, I don't want to sign up. I mean, from a human point of view and from the things of greatness and good and power, you say, this doesn't sound very exciting. The calling Jesus is giving is one that requires not just an understanding, but an experience. An experience of God in such a way that will change them forever. You see, they did not yet know, as he's talking to his disciples, that Jesus was going to die a horrible death on the cross, and then he would rise. He would defeat death. He would overcome it all. He would face the agony of all that humanity poured upon him. And then he would offer himself to save you and transform you and love you so that you could go and love others. So when Jesus said, when you're persecuted, flee to another place. He was saying, don't stop. Don't let the persecution stop you. Keep going. Then he gives them a promise. And as he looks here, he says, when you're persecuted, flee to another. I tell you the truth, you will not finish going through the cities of Israel before the Son of Man comes. And that is a promise. And that promise is that Christ is going to redeem and save. That means that he will be with his disciples. He will guide his disciples. His love will surround his disciples. That he will not be far from his disciples. He will be with you. They will not be alone. The greatest blessing in enduring what Christ is calling them to endure is the presence of God. It is an echo of Matthew 28:20. You will be victorious because I am with you. I am with you even unto the end of the age, he says. The greatest preparation for us all as a community is that God is with us. Are you ready for the challenge? Are you ready for the mission? Are you ready to fulfill your calling? Be prepared. Count the cost. Worship God every step of the way. And say, God, I will do what you've called me to do. Let us pray. Father, as we read these words, these are tough words, as we recognize what it means to follow you. I pray, Lord, we will lay our lives down. And in what it says in Galatians 2, that Paul says that I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. That Christ, you would compel us to serve and preach your message, to speak your word, to say what you desire for the world to know. That, Lord, our lives would be holy. Our lives would be unto you, totally and truly yours. That we would be filled with the Spirit. We would not waver, but we would serve you completely and entirely.